Joining us for our first jam session of the morning is Sarah Spain. You might recognize her as one of the top ESPN personalities. She's Chicago's own from Lake Forest, correct?
Yes.
Lake Forest. One heck of an athlete, maybe the best athlete at the table, I gotta be honest.
Wow.
On the way to the Final Four, they take on Michigan. I don't love the matchup. I actually think Michigan could win this game. What do you think?
I think they both could win the game. I think one of the most exciting parts about Loyola is it's sort of been the Cinderella run because they've got all the great storylines that aren't the basketball part between Sister Jean and the small school and not being there in so long. But then you get to the actual basketball, and they're one of the most prepared teams. They actually play exactly the style of basketball that Virginia, which was the number one seed overall that got bounced early, plays. So you're not looking at a team that's overachieved, really. You're just looking at one that maybe was under the radar for a really long time, and now everyone's like, oh, this is a real basketball team.
Well, like, to their credit, like what you said, you know, you think Michigan might bring it home, bring home the W. That's what they said about every other game for Loyola.
Yeah. So, well, this whole tournament, right? Yeah. And it's like you're trying to use whatever happened before to inform your next pick. And then you're like, that doesn't make any sense because it's been just straight chaos.
So what do you think their biggest challenge is going to be in this game?
I love this. I know.
She's
getting into basketball.
Getting into the sports.
It's a home team.
Right before she came on, she was like, I just don't really, sports is not my thing, but I'm working on it. That was a great question.
Thank you, Sarah.
You know what? I'm not really sure because normally you would say not letting the moment get too big for them. And that's been the most impressive part about this team. Their first three games, in each game, a different guy hit the game-winning shot with seconds to go. Those are the moments that you normally expect those 11 seeds that aren't expected to be there to kind of wither. And they are so prepared that their coach has them ready in every single moment. And whoever it is that gets the opportunity has stepped up. So the only thing that could slow them down, I guess, is if Michigan hits on all cylinders because they look incredible when they do.
One of the things we were debating in the sports radio world, which we both work in that medium, was if Loyola does win this national championship, do you think they get a parade like the Sox did when they won, like the Cubs did when they won most recently?
Right, they did way back in the 60s.
Yeah.
There's a bar that's still named after them. They have to rechange, you know, change the name to 18 instead of 63.
Yeah, right.
I think you'd have to say so, right? I don't think it's going to be anywhere near scale of the Cubs or the Blackhawks, but shut down a couple streets and give people a reason to party.
Maybe like a rally or something.
Yeah, for sure.
That'd be cool to all celebrate together.
You know, one of the things, Sarah, I was excited to get you in on because we've known each other from afar and have crossed paths professionally a little bit. But, you know, for me personally, dating somebody who's a female that works in this business, the sports business, there's some additional challenges being a woman that come with covering sports. I mean, you deal with a lot more than, say, a guy like I do in this business. What's been the experience for you as one of the top personalities at ESPN in a male-dominated industry?
You know, I think I was pretty naive coming in. My mom and dad have a law practice together. I've always been sort of a ball buster, so I was like, whatever I want to do, I'm going to do it. Mm-hmm. And people are going to be down with that because in the spaces that I usually was in, it was okay and it was encouraged to be a woman who wanted to, you know, kick some butt. And then social media, I think, is really where you start to realize that there's a lot of people that you maybe don't surround yourself with in your inner circle that genuinely believe there are spaces that women don't belong in. Whether or not they've even listened to anything you've said, it's just about the idea that you want to belong in a space that's been male dominated. So that's been tough. I think also, like, I tell people, I've gotten over this now, but when I started doing TV, I was so much less worried about what I was saying than what I was wearing because I felt really confident in what I knew. Yeah. But no matter what I wore, someone, those earrings or like your dress looks like a picnic table. And you try not to care about it, but you're like, when you're getting dressed in the morning, you're like, oh, now I've got to like think of all this stuff too. Especially when you're a tomboy and you're used to just throwing on a baseball cap and playing sports.
Yeah. You're a powerhouse on social media, though.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
All right, you got to clap back sometimes.
Yeah, there you go. All right, AskMen.com recently posted an article saying that you should absolutely never swipe right if you see a coworker on a dating website. In fact, you should just pretend like you never saw them on the site to begin with. Sarah, what's your thought on this one?
Well, thankfully, I met my husband before swiping left and right was a thing, so I got to avoid it, but I like to take over my friends' phones and do it. And my approach is if you see someone you know, then they probably are seeing you. So then you both know that you've seen each other. So then it's awkward if you swipe left and you can't ignore it. That's not an option. You have to choose something.
Yeah.
So you just swipe right and then you make a joke about it when you see them. Or if your company is big enough and they don't have policies against dating and you think that they're kind of fun, then you're like, let's see what happens when I swipe right and see if they're also thinking the same thing I am.
So for anyone that doesn't know what we're talking about, just for the social media and the dating app, swiping right means you want someone, swiping left means you don't want someone.
Yes, that's important.
Yeah, that is really important.
Yeah, you know, for me, I met my girlfriend in the workplace and I met her back, you know, maybe 4 years ago while we were working together in the sports industry. And it was one of those things where it's a different climate now than it was back then, but we kind of, there was no dating website involved. We kind of felt things out and took it slow. And then eventually it was just so obvious that we would be a perfect fit. It kind of happened organically. So I think it's okay to find the right person. There was no power position. She wasn't above me. I wasn't above her. We were on equal playing field, which I know is a very important part that me and Danielle have talked about. I think it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Also, don't you think that that just makes sense? If they're your coworker and you interact with them at all, then you've already kind of been figuring out if there's anything there. That's, I think, something sad about like the younger generation is they're still working on face-to-face contact and interacting with each other. It's easier on the phone. Mm-hmm. So like if you're leaving it up to the phone to say whether you're interested or not, that's kind of weird. You've met in person.
I love your idea of joking about it the day after.
Yeah, just
it diffuses all of it.